I think it's hard to process what's actually happening right now, which is most people are going to get COVID.
Transitioning from a pandemic to an endemic, health experts predict over time COVID-19 will become as common an illness as the flu, but there's debate over when the world will reach that stage. And the idea of a vaccine passport for certain venues still on the table in Baltimore City, but one major tourist attraction is taking that step on its own. Hello, everyone. I'm Jason Newsom. Welcome to 11 TV Hill. Since the pandemic began 2 years ago, there's been plenty of discussion on how long we'll live with COVID-19. Now we have more tools to control the virus. Vaccines are readily available. Children as young as 12 can get booster shots. But with hospitalizations still surging, when will the world transition out of the pandemic stage? And what could future variants mean for this development? And joining us now is Dr. Theodore Bailey. He's over at GVMC. He's the chief of the Division of Infectious Disease. Thanks for making time for us.
Good morning.
Let's talk first vocabulary right now, because we're talking about the word endemic and we're in the middle of a pandemic. What's the difference between the two?
With an endemic, we really would be talking about something that is a persistent, more or less regular part of our lives in terms of a certain rate of infections, a certain rate of severe illnesses, a certain rate of deaths. And we see that with other infectious diseases. For instance, we would have talked about smallpox, polio, measles as endemic infectious diseases. They weren't just something that was there for a year or two. They became a regular part of the fabric of our lives.
As we begin to see this being used in a lot of articles lately, as people and some experts are assuming that we could get there with COVID, how would we know that we've approached a new area of it being an endemic?
Well, we would be seeing, you know, we talk about these waves. That's not necessarily the way in which it's different. I think it's more of a mindset, to be honest, that it's something that, you know, we start to approach it with a different strategy of just it, right now we treat it as an exception. So it's something that shouldn't be there at all. And, you know, with something like these other infections, and I think you could talk about the cold, you could talk about flu, there's the seasons, they still come and go, but we expect them each year. And so part of it would be this a mentality of that this is part of what's around us. We expect to see it on an ongoing basis.
If the idea is that it becomes an expectation year to year, should also part of the expectation be that we'll live with inoculations, with vaccinations for these things every year? It's not a one-time event.
I think that's the background of Emmanuel's and other folks talking about this is the idea that there isn't going to be a stop point to it, that this may be something that's not eradicable. But that's also tricky because it's not just that pandemics are or are not eradicable and that endemics are not, but that you can eradicate either one. And that's why I led with the idea of, you know, smallpox, polio.
Sure.
These were things that were endemic. They weren't just suddenly a global pandemic or an outbreak. But nonetheless, with vaccine technology, we were able to eradicate them from our daily existence. So even if something becomes endemic, it's important to recognize that doesn't really end the question of what we ought to do about it. Should we really push to get it out of our communities, get it out of our nation, get it out of our world? Or is it something where that's not feasible? But it's tricky because the technology is there. The vaccines are highly effective and certainly have that ability to impact it, just as the vaccines impacted smallpox.
Yeah, I guess that was where I was going next. As we have all these tools in front of us, whether it's the vaccine or wearing the mask and that kind of thing, could we be heading on a course where if we could just get enough people, you know, to come around to it, that this could be history for us?
Yeah, I mean, the vaccines that we have for COVID are more effective than almost any vaccine we've had. You know, when we look at the level of protection that we're able to achieve, at least in the shorter term with it. It wasn't that we needed lifelong immunity to smallpox, it's that we needed to have worldwide immunity to it at a critical period so that it simply was snuffed out. So the vaccines are fully effective enough. It's just that, you know, they've not been taken up in quantity. And I don't just mean here in the U.S. where we have a vaccine gap. I'm talking really even more concerning is in other countries where the vaccine rate is the minority, where it's, you know, it's less than half the people.
When we've been talking about Omicron, we talk a lot about and focus on how easily it is spread, but we also talk about maybe, and this might not be the right word, but less potent, let's say, than the original variety. Does that mean, or is that a window into the future as we deal with other variants, that it may not be as strong?
Yeah, well, but again, you know, when we talk about smallpox, although it was endemic, it was able to generate quite severe infections.
Okay.
It's not the severity so much. It is the infectivity of it that is something that really just spreads without a group of people being really able to count on not getting it. You know, we've seen people who held off for 2 years, and with Omicron, within a week, maybe they suddenly get it, and they were still doing the same things that had protected them. So, you know, the infectivity is what could spread it, you know, so widely that it's really just in general present in the human population. Not everybody all at one time, fortunately.
Sure.
But without anybody really being able to keep away from it in the long term. So it's really a bit troubling, because even though it's less, I think you used the word less severe. A way to put that, though, is it's just less likely to be severe.
Okay.
And that reflects the idea that it has different effects in different people. So, you know, the question is always, what percentage of people are going to become severely ill? And I think it does seem clear that with Omicron, it's a lower percentage of the people who get infected who become severely ill, who need to go to the hospital, or who need to go into the ICU, or fortunately, who pass away from it. But if you take that less likely to be severe and you add it to very likely to be transmitted, you know, what we've seen is that it generates more cases, more hospitalizations than what we had seen previously. So we're lucky that it's not both things at once, more infectious and more deadly. But the fact that it's that combination has not been helpful to us. We've had our hospitals filled to the gill and still seeing people pass away. So what we really would need to see is something that's much less, even less severe, and we don't know that that's on tap for us.
Sure. So bottom line is, all the tools that we have learned since 2 years ago, don't stop. Keep wearing the mask. If you can get the vaccine, go and get it.
Yeah, we really should continue to push in that direction, because nobody simply acquiesced or just, you know, gave up on smallpox or polio or measles, for that matter. Right? They were recognized as something that was a year-to-year reality in our communities, but people pressed on with the vaccines, and now they're not a part of our daily existence. And with the vaccines that we have, COVID doesn't have to be either.
Sure. All right. That's Dr. Theodore Bailey over at GBMC. Thank you so much for the time. We appreciate it.
Take care.
Well, there's a new vaccination benchmark Baltimore City hopes to reach by the end of next month. The health department hopes by the end of February, 80% of city residents will be vaccinated. On top of that overall goal, there's also vaccine goals for children. By June 30th, city leaders want to get 60% of 5 to 11-year-olds at least partially vaccinated. By September 30th, the health department hopes 80% of that age group will have their shots. Right now, vaccinations are lagging among 12 to 17-year-olds and 18 to 34-year-olds. That has the city exploring the idea of vaccine passports for bars, restaurants, and entertainment venues.
Not so much your essential businesses where you would get some of those key supplies, but really those non-essential services. What previous cities have done, for example, you mentioned even carryout. It is not applicable to someone coming in to pick up a carryout or delivery meal. It is applicable to someone who would be dining inside of a restaurant.
The National Aquarium is adding their own vaccine requirements starting January 25th. Anyone older than 12 years old must be fully vaccinated to get in. Those who can't get vaccinated must show a negative PCR test. The aquarium is the first large-scale, kid-centric venue in Baltimore to implement this policy. And starting this week, Anne Arundel County Public Schools and the Department of Health will offer COVID vaccines for elementary school students. The clinics at 6 elementary schools, they are intended for children between the ages of 5 and 11. All of them will run from 5 to 7:30 at night. The first clinic will take place at Woodside Elementary in Glen Burnie. That'll be on Tuesday.